Cool. Hello, everyone. Welcome to our daily live stream. My name is Warren Williams. I'm one of the executive pastors at Redemption. And today, in honor of the conversation I'll be having with the guests I'll introduce here shortly, I'm wearing my Jets jersey, your 1968 Super Bowl champion Jets. As a Jets and Knicks fan, it's definitely a rough existence. So today we're going to be talking about sports, and I got my my boy Ralph here. I'll let him introduce himself. Ralph, just let the people know who you are. I know who you are, but for those who don't know you, give us your short bio.
I appreciate it, Warren. My name is Ralph Amsden. I am a sports reporter and analyst. I run my own site called Arizona Varsity. We cover a lot of high school sports all over the state of Arizona. I have a podcast covering the Pac-12, so the Big 12 colleges on the western side of the United States. And then for about 5 years, I did a lot of work covering Arizona State basketball and football as well.
That's awesome, man. And he's a good man because he didn't use this opportunity to take a shot at the Jets or the Knicks or any of my failing teams. So you're really a good man because the tables were turned. I probably would have taken that opportunity. So, thank you for that because I get enough heat and flack for my fandom. But today we're going to be talking about the loss of sports. And, if you're probably like Ralph and I, you're just experiencing this this loss, right? Like I'm a huge baseball fan, and the baseball MLB is shut down and NBA is shut down, and all these normal sporting events that we use like fill our time and for our enjoyment, to watch for our enjoyment are just gone because of this pandemic. So we're going to be talking about like the loss of sports. We're going to get into some of what Ralph does, and also some of the exciting things that he's working on this season. So part of what we do at Redemption is we do all of life interviews where we look at how various people in our congregation are embodying the phrase, all of life is all for Jesus, and their various vocations and ministries and spheres where God has placed them. So Ralph, how do you reflect God's character in the field of being a sports analyst?
I think by trying to, in what I do, we deal with a lot of kids. And yeah. So, it's kind of a minefield, right? Like, everyone always said they feel like it's free range to say whatever you want about a professional athlete, say whatever you want about collegiate athletics, but we deal with high school kids too. These are other people's kids. They're minors. Their brains aren't fully formed yet. And one of the things that we try to do is, celebrate their accomplishments, but also celebrate the people who do things the right way.
Yeah.
And we always try to stress that, like, this isn't your identity. Sports is an opportunity. Sports is a pastime. Sports can even be a profession. But it's never at the core of who you are. And so we try to reflect that too by letting people get to know us and see our other interests and show that we're interested in more than what they're doing on the field. Promote good citizenry. Yeah. We try to connect a lot of kids around the state with each other so that they can support each other and get to know each other and stuff like that. I just think that for me, it all comes down to identity. Yeah. I might not be the best ambassador for Jesus every single day, but the one thing that's always on the forefront of my mind is that what I do is not my identity, and what these kids are doing is not their identity. These collegiate athletes, these professional athletes, it's just what they're doing, right? And every day is an opportunity to show how your life was changed. And so, I try to make sure that I'm never shy if somebody wants to ask me about, my experience with that. We don't go out of our way, to promote Christians in what we do. But the fruits of the Spirit are important. And when we see them, we point them out and we ask people about them. And also, we try to reflect at some level. It can be really tough in sports because there's so much bravado and it's all about competition, but the most important thing about sports is the humility that you get to learn from.
Yeah.
Nobody wins every single time. Everybody loses. You find out about yourself in a loss. You find out what you can do differently in a loss. Every loss is an opportunity. And I see that as the same way in my walk. Every time that I mess up, that's an opportunity to get right, you know.
Dude, so we live
in kind of a graceless society, you know. We all kind of feed into it, especially with the most of the sports discourse happening online, right? So that's just to remind people, spend a lot of time reminding people, like, hey, these are human beings, and we mess up too. And every time we mess up, that's an opportunity to turn around and do things better.
Man, that's so good. I think your part about identity there is so huge, because we do see that when, like, you know, we build up, you know, our athletes are like built up to these astronomical levels, and then something happens in their career that throws it off track. And because their identity was so wrapped up in being, you know, able to hit 500-foot home runs or to, you know, have the smoothest jump shot, you know, when that is taken away for whatever reason, you know, we see how many lives have been like derailed. Like they even in like the recovery of some of the, of those stories, like you'll see where they came back around or like, oh, like I noticed that my identity was like wrapped up in that and it was actually the worst thing for me. So it's really interesting that I'm really encouraged to hear that you, you know, encourage them to look beyond their identity as an athlete and like just to realize that that's not the totality of who they are. So that's really cool, man. Yeah.
Well, you talk about that. Somebody hits 500-foot home run,
yeah,
and the entire stadium gets up and they cheer.
Right.
You strike out five times in a row, those same people that cheered you are going to boo. Yeah. But that's, you know, Jesus isn't on that vibe, right?
He's, right.
You know, you strike out, you hit a home run. That's not what he's interested in.
Right.
He's interested in your heart. And you can become a better athlete, mm-hmm, just like you can become a better person,
mm-hmm,
seeking to serve others around you. And, you know, my wife's not, you know, super into athletics, but that's something that she's, you know, always taught me, is that you serve by, you lead by serving.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, like, if you can become a servant leader, and you can mentor the people around you, because a real leader creates other leaders.
That's right.
You know, you can absolutely become a better leader, business person, athlete through the pursuit of Jesus, just like you can become a better person. It's not, right, you know, and so you could be the worst baseball player in the entire major league, and Jesus isn't going to love you any less. And I think that's just important to remind people that that constant is there.
Right, right. No, that's so good. So, man, before, you know, we were all in the situation where we're getting excited to watch 30-year-old documentaries and 14-year-old baseball games, and I have to – because I'm now living in Arizona, I have to rewatch or relive the moment that the Diamondbacks beat the Yankees a million times in Game 7. So before we got to this place, like, what was that moment or that maybe that league or event that was canceled where you were like, oh, no, like, this is actually getting serious? And, like, how is it – how has this whole shutdown, like, affected your work?
Well, you know, there's no live sports to cover. Obviously, you know, I'm in a holding pattern just like everybody else as far as, you know, is there going to be anything to cover in the near future? I try to put myself aside because, you know, I know that I've been affected by things like sickness in the past, you know, having a very serious effect on my own family. And, you know, I wouldn't wish that my irresponsible actions would put anybody in situations that I've been in, scary situations, right? And so I'm more than happy to understand that sports is a privilege and it's a luxury and it's a beautiful thing. And I fully believe that we need it as a society because we're very, very tribal. Most of the bad, mm-hmm, things that have happened in this world come from our tribalism.
Mm-hmm.
But for some reason, we found a way to channel it where there's actually some positivity and, yeah, community building that is relatively harmless if done right and can really enhance the value of your life through sports. And so I do think sports is incredibly valuable, but nothing teaches that it's secondary and a privilege and a luxury like everything just getting shut down yeah. out of the blue. But, you know, I was bugging people around me in late February, early March, and saying, hey, this is going to be a much bigger deal than maybe some people are making it out to be. And then when March 11th came around and the Tom Hanks news dropped right before Rudy Gobert of the Utah Jazz tested positive, and they had to shut down an entire game before tip-off with 19,000 people sitting in the crowd in Salt Lake City. That hour, it was like, okay, everything from – and I that was something I even tweeted. I was like, when we wake up tomorrow, this is going to be a very different world.
Wow.
And I will say that, like, that doesn't mean that I was fully prepared for the complete extent of how wild this was going to be. But, you know, I did feel like early in March, maybe we weren't taking it as seriously as we needed to. And in mid-March, I felt like things were kind of getting around to maybe the way they should be. But here we are a month and a half later with not a whole lot of answers and a lot of anxiety building up in the populace about, you know, what's worse, you know, economic anxiety or you know, the health and welfare of the vulnerable populace. And I think that, you know, that level of animosity and divide is the one thing I could never have prepared for.
Yeah, man. Yeah, for sure. I still have that like image or that image of that video of Rudy Gobert like touching all the mics in the press conference.
I said that every failure is an opportunity to do better. You know, if Rudy hadn't have done that, maybe people don't get as scared immediately into taking this seriously. There's a genuine possibility that Rudy Gobert being irresponsible saved lives. And that's just one of the ways that you have choices in how you look at some of these things. And so I know there are a lot of people that are really, really mad at him, including some of his own teammates. But at the same time, you know, this was coming regardless of whether he was the catalyst for it or not. But putting a face to some of this stuff so that we can relate it to ourselves is a really big deal, because it's really hard to make a sacrifice when you don't see how it impacts you. And that really, him and Tom Hanks in the same day, that put a really big face on everything.
Yeah, no, that's really good. Really true. And yeah, like you said, whether he touched the mics or whatever, like this was coming regardless. So
yeah,
he's easily, because of his actions, like he's easily can be made like a scapegoat. But like reality is that, you know, things were going to shut down anyway because of how easily and fast this thing is spreading. So let's have some grace for and show some mercy to Rudy Gobert. I'm sure we've all done stupid things, maybe not to that extent, but in somewhere in our past. So really good. So with this loss of sports, you know, I know this is definitely affecting, you know, the things that you do professionally in probably ways that are really tough and hard. But I'm just curious to hear, like, what have been any reflections that you've had with this loss of, you know, sporting events, both positive and negative?
My goal when I got into covering sports in the first place was to have a community of people that I got to do some fun things around, and, you know, we were able to support each other. The business is not like I idealistically envisioned it to be. You know, it's still a business. You're still in the business of scooping people. You're still in the business of getting stories first. There's definitely some competition there. There's some people that are certainly in it for themselves. And I've had to reconcile that over time. But I still believe that what this is about is creating a more vibrant and informed and entertained community. And so because of that, my goal has always been to develop relationships with people that are lasting and that move from having an identity inside of sports to actually caring about each other. So sports shutting down just gives me the opportunity to tend to the foundation that I was trying to build over time. So everybody that I have had an opportunity to work with and talk with, I've probably spoken more to them in this last month than I would have otherwise, you know, just checking in on each other, making sure that, you know, that everybody's good. And, you know, some of those conversations have been productive, and you know, and some of them, some of our anxieties and frustrations have been on full display. But I will say that I don't care when sports comes back. I just want the best for everybody involved. This industry has afforded me the opportunity to create some lasting relationships, and I care about those people more than I care about what I do. That's how I've been spending my time, and I've really enjoyed the opportunity to have people care for me and to be able to care for other people.
That's so good, man. And I think this has been good for us in a lot of ways, because in many ways, sports, like weather, are one of those, as like some of those things that sometimes in conversations we can go to very easily to fill the time or to fill the space or to kind of minimize the awkwardness of conversation. So I'm hoping that, you know, with those things not being available, with sports not being available, that like we can maybe have some more deeper conversations, maybe deepen some of the things that we're talking about, or we talk about in some of our relationships, rather than just like, oh, did you see, you know, whatever, you know, this play, or, you know, did you hear about what this athlete tweeted, and all, you know what I mean? So, you know, I think I love sports, and I do want them to come back, but I'm right there with you, man. Like, I want it to be come back in a way that's like safe, right? And and even if that means like, I know there are a whole bunch of ideas being bounced around about having fanless sort of events or whatever it may be, but like whatever way protects, you know, all involved, you know, if that means us having to wait out longer, to me that's worth the wait. So what are some things, fill us in on like anything new that you're working on. I know we talked beforehand about some new things that you're doing with your website. Fill us in on some of that.
So we talked a little bit about that mindset of just wanting to build a community and create cool things together. I know, you know, you being a musician, that's something that you've always aspired to and had an opportunity to do. It's something I've had the opportunity to collaborate with a lot of people as well. And I was thinking about, you know, every year you sit down and you reassess, because I'm not one of those people that like got a good job, a good paying job in sports right out of college, or was able to even build up to that. I didn't start going to ASU till, gosh, I had to be like 25 years old. And so I already had one kid. I had another on the way. I couldn't go do internships. Erin was already paying my way through school. So putting any more on her plate was out of the question. They ended up moving the Cronkite School of Journalism to downtown Phoenix while I was on campus in Tempe. And so I ended up having to drop the sports broadcasting part of my major anyway, and just finish with a degree in literature. Don't get a STEM degree, kids. You can read books on your own time. You don't take out loans.
Hey, man, don't knock all those fine arts degrees.
Hey, it's not the best thing about a fine arts degree is the day that they hand you that diploma, and then afterward you're like, oh, I'm in the real world now. I got to figure out what to do with this. So the college experience is absolutely fantastic, but if there wasn't much that an English literature degree was going to do for me in the world of sports. And so not being able to intern, I couldn't just go out and say to people, hey, you know, I could be good at this. Trust me, you know, and I tried that route, and I, you know, it was really, really hard to get a gig. So I ended up starting my own website about almost 9 years ago. And that's been the life ever since, is having to build it on my own. And it's been really nice, because I've kind of been able to set my own hours, my own agenda, my own my own goals, and build the thing that I want to build. And going into this year, I was like, how do I take that to the next level? Because my ultimate goal in life is just to make cool stuff with the people that I want to be around.
Yeah.
And I've always known that that's probably not a practical thing to do. And so this year I decided to break up my business, my company that I own, and just give it to people. And so we are going to relaunch the website that I run, Arizona Varsity, from being like a high school sports coverage website to we're going to cover just Arizona culture, sports, music, with a huge anchor in high school sports, because that's what we already do. And we're going to continue that. But everybody that contributes to it from here on out is going to be part owner of the business. And so what they pour into, they're going to be getting back from. And I love the idea of sort of building a sports writing co-op or community together that we can come together and just make cool stuff, not have to worry about how many people click on our stories, not have to worry about deadlines, not have to worry about, you know, doing just, you know, the game write-ups that, you know, here's what happened in the game, you know, going deeper in the whole like Bloom's taxonomy thing. Like let's be analytical. Let's tell more life stories. Let's do some positive things. Let's invest into Arizona and tell some stories that we want to tell and make sure that it's rewarding for us. And we're not just in this cutthroat business where we're at the mercy of whether or not somebody's advertising check comes in or not, because a lot of my friends are losing their jobs right now. Mm. And so, you know, this might not work, but it's going to be the most fun I ever had failing if it does fail. So I'm really excited to kind of revamp what it is we're doing and just do it as a group. And, you know, and I think just that togetherness and that community is what sports is all about. And I think we can reflect it a little bit more in our industry and in that, just be able to be around people and be supportive and try to meet their needs and be, you know, like Will always talks about, be vulnerable enough to allow your needs to be known and have them, you know, meet those too. Some of these people are Christians, some of these people aren't, you know, that's of no consequence to me. You know, we're loving our neighbors no matter who our neighbors are. So, and yeah, that's what we're doing from here on out. We're kicking it off on May 1st, and we'll see if it works out.
Oh man, that sounds so exciting. And I'm like so excited to see the ways that you guys are going to display just the beauty of like sports and music and all the beautiful things that's going on in Arizona. I think Arizona needs some good promo. we need some good representation to the greater world, because there's a lot of awesome stuff happening here, and I feel like the perception of what Arizona is and like, you know, greater America or world is not fair. It's not a fair representation.
We need people who have been here for a decade not coming on these streams wearing Jets shirts.
Hey, what up, man? Listen, I've only been here for half a decade, number one.
Okay. Well, now I got 5 years to bring you over.
Yeah, maybe in 5 years we can talk, but for now, my allegiances still stay with the hometown teams, all right? So we're just going to leave that there. So we'll be praying for you as you launch this new endeavor. Is there anything any other ways that we can be praying for you during this time?
Yeah, I mean, I'm like anybody else, you know. I've got my fears and triggers and anxieties, and you know, sports is a weird world where we all have. I remember back in the day, you know, everybody knows Stephen A. Smith. If you're a sports fan, and he used to write for the Philadelphia Inquirer, and I remember being 12, 13 years old, and I'd call and leave him voicemails. Right? We just want our opinions to be heard, and now we all just have so much access to each other. You know, if somebody wants to get a hold of me, there's 8 different ways they can do it, and it happens instantaneously. I get a notification if any random anonymous person anywhere on the internet wants to say anything about anything that I'm doing at any time. And so I have to make 300-400 choices a day of, you know, what mood am I in right now? Do I respond? Do I take this personal? How do I reflect the God that redeemed me from the person that redeems me from the person that I am? On a daily basis, because you know, I hear a lot of people, you know, get up when they have a platform, they get up and say like, "Hey, I'm not a perfect person," but there are very specific ways in which I'm imperfect, and a lot of it just has to do with, you know, my upbringing, and you know, I'm a big anti-bully guy, and sometimes being anti-bully puts you in a position where you're pushing people
around,
right? And so I got to make decisions every single day about my mindset and how I respond to people. I fail a whole bunch in how I want to portray myself, even though that's who I am. I'm an absolute mess, right? But in showing what God has done for me to transform my life, over time and what he continues to do for me. And to just make sure that I'm being an ambassador for that transformation and for the grace he shows me by being gracious to others, whether they deserve it or not, and no matter what my triggers are. So, you know, I'm in a public facing position where passions are inflamed, where we're in a huge era of uncertainty. And you know, I can be a jerk to people sometimes, and I don't mean to, and I don't want to. And, you know, them giving it to me first is never an excuse for, you know, for anything that I do. And so it's just making sure that I, you know, if there was prayer on me, more prayer than there is now for my own proud self to get on my knees every day and say, make sure that I am gracious today. Make sure that I am grateful today, so that my outlook on this world, no matter how sketchy and conflict oriented it is and how uncertain things are, that I'm not in a position where I forget to be grateful and I forget the grace that was given to me. Those prayers can do nothing but help people like me. And I can only really speak for myself, but you know, that's something I'm in the middle of it right now, just knowing like, man, I have to be sympathetic and empathetic to the fact that everybody is at a different level of anxiety right now. And sometimes the things that people say to me are coming from a completely different place. And their upbringing is involved and their economic anxieties are involved. And just, you know, I need to love people, man. I need to love people and I'm not able. So it's got to be God, right? So he's got to be there in that moment. And so if I'm not close to him in that moment, if I've stepped far away, it's going to be more of me talking to those people. And I'm a mess. And so that's just it, you know, just make sure that my heart's in the right place, chasing the right things, so that when I get a chance to talk to people, if that's their impression of the God that changed my life is someone who is not acting very changed, that I don't go out and do some damage. You know, that's what's important to me right now.
That's amazing, man. And friends, I think we can all relate in many ways to what Ralph is saying, you know, with just the amount of discourse that we have online and just what can, you know, this kind of disembodied experience that we're living now through Zoom calls and through like Facebook and Instagram. But, you know, it's easy to like forget people's humanity, like when, you know, when we're getting maybe there's an opinion that's expressed that we don't agree with, or somebody's like directly verbally attacking us in certain ways. It's like, you know, as believers, we know that, like Ralph has said many times, like we're all a mess, right? And like we remember the grace that was extended to us in spite of our mess. And you know, what a great representation of Christ to extend that grace to others, even if they're you know, not being the most loving at that time. So Ralph, I want to thank you for coming on, and I pray for everyone who's like going through this time where we don't have sports, that this time will be a worshipful time for you, that it will be a restful time, that you would have had maybe some conversations with people who previously all you maybe brought up, could talk about or would talk about our sports. And maybe during this time, I hope that you've been able to have some more deeper and interesting conversations. And I long for the return of sports, but I at the same time long for health and safety of people. So again, Ralph, thank you for coming on. I want to thank you guys for watching, and we'll see you tomorrow.
Love you, buddy.
Love you too, man.